World War I flying aces. The phrase conjures up a romantic moment in history when chivalrous airborne knights jousted with each other, held aloft by primitive machines made mostly of wood. Old Rhinebeck is a small town in beautiful upstate New York where crowds gather to watch an air show like this one, a detailed reenactment of the years when man and machine were first joined together in the air. 75 years later, the era still holds a powerful grip on the public imagination. It was a time when heroes were made in the air, men who could rely only on their skill and courage to bring them to victory. Behind the romance and adventure of the World War I aces is a critical story in the history of war. Used for the first time in the early months of the war, aircraft forever changed the nature of combat. The ferociously bloody battle along the banks of the Marne River in September of 1914 was the first major conflict of the war. The terrible loss of life on the ground pounded home the need for a different type of warfare, thus speeding up the development of the aircraft as a tactical weapon. Just 11 years after the Wright brothers' first flight, the aircraft at the start of World War I was a very new piece of military technology. The great powers had only a small number of these flying machines, and the military establishments envisioned little for the fragile and unreliable aircraft beyond simple reconnaissance. Prior to the use of aircraft, the only way to do reconnaissance was with stationary balloons moored to the earth with steel cables. These balloons were far less maneuverable than airplanes and also far more difficult to defend. The huge balloons made a pretty easy target. Imagine the lack of enthusiasm on the part of the soldiers who were assigned to sit for hours in the wicker baskets with only a pair of binoculars to defend them, not knowing when a far-off buzzing might gradually get louder, signaling the presence of an attacking enemy aircraft. The Albatross Scout was on the cutting edge of military aviation in early 1915. The infamous German flying service often led the way in development of new aircraft. Although Albatross Scouts similar to this were used mostly for reconnaissance, they usually carried a Parabella machine gun on the rear cockpit gun ring. The plane was powered by a 160-horsepower Mercedes-Benz engine, capable of reaching 85 miles per hour in the open air. It took this plane 45 minutes to climb to its ceiling of 12,000 feet. crews assigned to early reconnaissance missions perform admirably, but could only watch as their enemy did the same work, since neither side had the equipment to deny the other the air. But soon pilots began carrying pistols, rifles, and shotguns, and a new phase in the war began. When Lieutenant Waterfell was shot down by the German Air Force over Belgium in September of 1914, he became the first casualty of over 7,500 men in the British Flying Forces alone during the war. The first aerial bombing started a few months later with crude and dangerous devices consisting of nothing more than a canister of gasoline that was supposed to ignite on impact with the ground. The British Sopwith Camel is the most famous of all the World War I aircraft. Armed with dual Vickers machine guns, the crafty Camel approached speeds of 120 miles per hour. As the aircraft became more sophisticated, they also became far more deadly. Over 50,000 airmen lost their lives during the 4 years of the war, many spiraling to their deaths like this in their flimsy wing coffins. Rare footage from inside the German Falz factory shows the tremendous turnaround that occurred in 1916 with respect to the manufacture of aircraft. Prior to 1916, neither side had adequate manufacturing capability, but that all changed after the military powers realized the deadly potential of these machines. The storied German craftsmanship was applied in full force to the manufacture of these lightweight aircraft. For much of the war, aerial superiority would flip-flop between the German and Allied forces, depending mostly on whose manufacturing capabilities were greater. World War I was truly the first war decided in part by the legacy of the Industrial Revolution. The Falz D-3 carried twin forward-firing machine guns. The synchronized mechanism allowed the bullets to shoot in between the propeller's revolutions. Hot off the line, the new Falz is taken for a test flight. Probably the last peaceful moments the plane would spend while airborne. When Anton Fokker first was asked to demonstrate his synchronized machine gun for the dubious German high command, he proceeded to fly over the airfield and strafe a series of targets, scaring the wits out of the high-ranking officers. The Albatross D-3 was introduced early in 1917, probably World War I's definitive fighter. This aircraft was an improvement on the D-2, with dual Spandau machine guns and better aerodynamics and performance. As it became more likely that America would soon enter the war, the German High Command realized that they needed a victory quickly or would have to face massive infusions of fresh troops. They placed great faith in the new Albatross to help them achieve this quick victory. The legendary flying circus of Baron von Richthofen, officially known as Jasta II, flew a group of these albatrosses painted bright red. The plane usually identified with the Red Baron is perhaps the most recognizable of all World War I aircraft, the Fokker triplane. Designed by the brilliant Dutch engineer Anton Fokker, it was introduced into combat in August 1917 and quickly became the favorite plane of von Richthofen because of its superior lift capability. Von Richthofen was perhaps the most dazzling of all the World War I aces. The Red Baron scored 80 kills, more than any other pilot of the war. Taking over command of the squadron of the great Oswald Boelcke after his death, von Richthofen molded his flyers into the most feared group to take to the air, officially known as Jasta II, but called the Flying Circus by the Allies. This elite team struck terror into the hearts of Allied airmen, a formation of killers flying Albatross D-3s and led by the Fokker triplane, all painted top to bottom in bright scarlet. Von Richthofen's last victim was British 2nd Lieutenant D.E. Lewis. On April 20, 1918, Lewis was on patrol with his squadron. As they neared the German front, they encountered the Jasta II. Lewis banked his machine and found himself face to face with the Red Baron. Lewis tried to maneuver his Sopwith Camel out of the Baron's line of fire, but Richthofen's trigger finger was too fast, and the blaze of machine gun fire tore into the Camel's reserve fuel tank. Lewis hit the ground at 60 miles an hour, but was unhurt. As he climbed from his wreck, he saw Richthofen's plane fly within a few feet. Certain he was about to be shot, Lewis stared at the red plane. The Baron flew past, waving cheerfully at his latest victim. Hermann Göring was an officer in a scouting cyclist regiment who spent much time in and out of hospitals with painful rheumatism. He was an impulsive character full of wild ideas about battle tactics. And during one of his hospital stays, he met another officer who persuaded him to transfer to the air service. Goering shot down 22 planes and took over command of von Richthofen's squadron after the Red Baron's death. Goering's name will forever be linked with the Nazi regime in World War II as he organized Hitler's Gestapo and became the head of the Luftwaffe, the German Air Force. He was convicted of war crimes during the Nuremberg trials and committed suicide in his prison cell. Dotted across the French countryside, airfields like this launched squadron after squadron of Allied fighter pilots into battle. The airfields were often makeshift and temporary, a few shacks and communication lines in the middle of cleared farmland. Georges Guynemer was France's most beloved ace. He was a frail 21-year-old who weighed less than 100 pounds. Guynemer was working as a janitor at a French training field outside of Paris, stricken with tuberculosis. His unstoppable persistence, however, ultimately landed him in the pilot seat. He possessed superb aerial skill and marksmanship, and between the summer of 1915 and September 1917, Guynemer destroyed 54 enemy aircraft, a record surpassed only by René Fonck. Guynemer was shot down over no man's land in the midst of a furious artillery barrage, and his body was never found. The death of Guynemer spawned a legend among the French. They believe that he flew so high he could never come back, and as far as they know, he's still circling above them, keeping watch on all French airmen. Only one of many French aces. Some of the most colorful of these men included Lieutenant William Thaw, Commandant Brocard, Lieutenant Dorme, credited with 23 victories, Captain de la Tour, Captain Delon, who shot down 19 German planes, and Sous-Lieutenant Raymond, with 4 kills. René Fonck was an unbelievable shot, a brilliant pilot, and a great leader of men. France's ace of aces began life as the son of peasant farmers, but he grew up to shoot down 75 enemy aircraft, more victories than anyone except the Red Baron. After the war, he served as inspector of fighter aircraft in the French government for many years. favorite machine was the SPA-13, and together they twice shot down six enemy planes in one day, a feat that no other pilot of the war could claim. The British Royal Flying Corps had their share of famous aces. The pride of the RFC was the Canadian Billy Bishop, who finished the war with 72 confirmed victories. In his most frightening dogfight, Bishop, piloting his SE-5, dueled with the mighty Red Baron. In the midst of battle, Bishop's machine gun jammed, leaving him at the mercy of von Richthofen. For some reason, Richthofen decided not to fire and spared Bishop's life. The dogfight ended when British reinforcements flew in and forced the Germans to retreat. Bishop was joined by dozens of equally brave flyers, among them Major Edward McManock, who would outwit the Germans by pretending to be hit and putting his SE-5 into a spinning dive. Captain Albert Ball shot down 44 German aircraft before he was shot down at the ripe age of 20. He was decorated with the Victoria Cross, the Cross of Chevalier, Legion of Honor, and the Russian Order of St. George. The SE-5 single-seat fighter was delivered to the front in March of 1917. It was powered by a 150-horsepower Hispano-Suiza engine and had a maximum speed of 120 miles per hour, which was faster than either the French-built Nieuports or Spads. The SE-5 was armed with a Vickers machine gun that fired through the propeller and a drum-fed Lewis machine gun mounted over the wing. When Germany announced it would carry out unrestricted submarine warfare, the United States was forced to abandon its tenuous hold on isolationism. America officially declared war on April 6, 1917. Secretary of War Newton Baker had long argued that American involvement was vital to the future of Europe. President Wilson finally realized he had no choice but to commit fully to the war effort. For the first time in its history, America would send its armies across the sea. World War I was also America's first conflict as an industrial nation, and the citizens responded in a way never seen before. Workers who had weeks before been building Model T automobiles were now mounting propellers onto British-designed DH-4s. Planes were built in remodeled American plants and test flown in the States before being shipped overseas. To make the long journey across the Atlantic, it was necessary to disassemble the planes and crate them in large containers, which were then placed on ships. Thank you. Once in Europe, the aircraft were reassembled and then tested again in the air. Some of the test flights ended roughly as freshly trained pilots attempted to fly these unwieldy beasts for the first time. Many of the Americans had flown with the legendary Lafayette Escadrille, a squadron made up of American privateers who shot down many German planes before the U.S. officially entered the war. Captain Field Kinley had 12 kills. Major Raoul Lufberry had 18 confirmed victories. And Captain Elliot Springs had 12 kills. America's top ace was former race car driver Eddie Rickenbacker with 26 kills. The optimism of 1914 had long passed, and the mood in 1918 on both sides was close to desperation. The air battles in the last year of the war were the most furious of all, as hundreds of aircraft would battle each other at one time, filling the sky with their daring tactics. On April 21, 1918, Manfred von Richthofen was to fly his last mission. Trapped between ferocious ground fire and aerial machine gun attacks, the Red Baron would finally be brought down. Attacked from above by Captain Roy Brown and from below by lethal anti-aircraft fire, von Richthofen's triplane was fatally hit. Australian soldiers recovered the body and were shocked to learn that the dead pilot was none other than Baron von Richthofen. A memorial wreath and letter were dropped from a plane over German territory. Von Richthofen was buried by the British and given full military honors. After the war, the body was exhumed and taken by train to Berlin, where it lay in state for 2 days before burial. How much the loss of their greatest hero, von Richthofen, affected the German effort cannot be known. But 6 months later, peace finally came to the world as Germany agreed to a full surrender. The war cost the lives of over 50,000 airmen and forever changed the face of aviation. The 4 years brought a revolution in both military use of aircraft and also in the development of the aircraft themselves. Many of the World War I aces stayed in aviation after the war, trading in their uniforms for civilian clothing. The X-Fighter aces formed the backbone of the newly developing aviation industries, which included postal airmail service, civilian air travel, and a new form of entertainment provided by pilots who barnstormed across the country and performed dazzling daredevil feats for an enthusiastic public. F-117A, also known as the Stealth Fighter, is the most technologically advanced fighter to ever grace the sky. But the sophisticated machine still needs skilled pilots to fly her. Pilots who in spirit share much with the legendary fighter aces of World War I.